You're listening to the Chris or Jenny Show, featuring me on WCOM LP Chapel Hill and Carborough.
You know it's featuring Deej.
Nope, it's featuring me, all right.
Oh my goodness. Listen to this, honey. I've got Rissi Palmer on the show tonight.
Wow.
She was in Rolling Stone magazine.
That is so cool.
I know. Her daughter, I think, is just almost your age. I'm going to see if she wants to play on our soccer team. They just live in Durham.
Uh-huh. That'll be fun.
You think she'll want to play on our team, maybe?
Maybe.
We'll find out.
Yep, we will.
Okay, anything else before we start the show?
One thing.
What?
Let's start the show!
Can you do it without yelling?
No!
Okay, thank you, honey. Yeah, you are listening to the Chris or Jenny Show featuring Deej, that's me, on WCUMLP Chapel Hill in Carborough. Good evening, friends.
Good evening, friendos.
You love it, Deej.
What if we couldn't get home to North Carolina?
Well, we'd be stuck in Virginia or South Carolina, Deej, I suppose, in that situation.
Is South Carolina, Carolina? If someone's like, I'm going to Carolina, is that South Carolina? It kind of is, but it kind of isn't.
Those dudes are from around here.
For sure.
Snow camp.
Yeah.
That's 30 minutes from
Went
here.
Went to a haunted house there once.
One of the Tan Sober gentlemen works at, in the heart of Carborough, Open Eye Cafe.
Yeah.
Listen to this text. Jenny Detweiler, friend of the show, friend of ours. I just saw a tan and sober gentleman standing on the side of the road.
Mm?
The one with the mohawk and the long ponytail.
Oh.
His car had broken down. Now, she's referring to Ben Noblet, who the leader of the Tan and Sober gentleman, yeah, who we've had on the show. Listen to this. Now he's a burnt and angry gentleman.
Oh, no. He can handle it. He's the tough one.
That's a text from Jenny Detweiler. I thought that was good.
Thanks, yeah, Jenny.
So. Have you been into the Olympics at all, Deej?
Haven't been watching it that much. I'm a big baseball fan.
And yeah, you are.
Baseball and softball are back in the Olympics. But the problem is, okay, softball, that's the best of the best. Like, you know, like the women out there on the field. Yeah. Those are the best softball players in the world.
They're the best softball players in the world.
But the baseball players, it's like minor leaguers and like washed up dudes.
Your point is the best players in the world are not playing in the Olympics.
In baseball, no. It is not the best of the best. It is the best of the unemployed.
Why aren't the best MLB players playing? Contracts?
They're just playing Major League Baseball right now and they don't want to risk. You know, they want to stop the season. They don't want to risk getting injured for...
Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, I kind of get that because it is in the midst of the season. You're probably mostly thinking about United States players, but are also the best players from Cuba.
Okay, so U.S. definitely the best are not playing. The best Dominican players are in the majors. The best Venezuelan players are in the majors. Now, the Japanese team, I would say, okay, the best Japanese player is Shohei Ohtani. He's in the majors. He's not playing. The Japanese league's kind of weird because they're very protective of their... there's all these rules. You can only have so many gaijin on each team, like so many foreigners.
Okay.
So the Japanese team is the best Japanese players. They're sending their best, except a lot of their best are in the majors and aren't there. But I would say the Japanese teams are definitely the strongest. And I wouldn't be surprised to see Japan win the gold medal this year.
Yeah.
The problem is, I don't blame the Olympics. The problem is the fact that it's during the baseball season.
Here's my solution. You're going to laugh. Make baseball a winter Olympic sport. That way it's not during the season. Yeah, it's a summer sport. But, you know, just build a ballpark. You know, it's the Olympics. Just build an indoor stadium. Like, you build a luge track that only gets used once. I mean, why not build, like, an indoor ballpark to play baseball
in? That's not a bad idea.
And then we can send, you know, we can have, like, Mike Trout and Max Scherzer instead of, like, you know, Todd Frazier and some guy I've never heard of.
That's,
I don't know. Hey.
That's not a terrible point, Deej.
When I am king, Chris.
I want to get into ping pong.
Okay.
Why do the ping pong players need coaches?
Ping pong's one of those things that, like, it's easy to be okay at, but, like, kind of get up in that upper 1%. There's a lot of strategy.
I feel like everything I needed to know in ping pong, I could play. We had a table at my house growing up.
Yeah.
And I have two brothers. We beat the crap out of each other ping pong on a regular basis. You have a couple of brothers.
I did. Yeah, we had a table in the basement for years. Yeah. And on that greenwood, I saw a lot of tears.
Yeah, yeah. Same in my house.
Yeah.
We had a gazebo.
Mostly my tears, just to be clear. My brother Mark was definitely the big dog.
My brother Lauren will disagree with this. Lauren Ansbury has been on the show. I think I'm probably the best ping pong player of my family. But my point is, Deej, I feel like I knew everything I needed to know about ping pong at age 12. And then at that point, until you're in the Olympics, it's all about effort and practice. Do they really need a coach? And did you notice they take a towel break every 6 points?
It's exhausting. You get sweaty. What's the boxing strategy? Rope-a-dope, where you just try to tire out your opponent? Yeah. I think, like, sometimes in ping pong, you know, I think if you just kind of play defensively and you're like, okay, I might not score as many points, but if I just, like, play defensively and prevent them from scoring, maybe they'll screw up.
The U.S. player had, like, a brace on his arm, like one, like the athletic tape that the swimmers wear. Right now, folks, I'm going to just say it live on the show. I'm going to recommend DJ Simons as the 2024 Olympic ping pong coach.
On it.
Who's going to argue with that?
Hey, you know what?
What do you say to the players?
Hey, okay, do you ever, like, play ping pong and then, you know, they hold the ping pong table like this, you know, like they're holding a pencil, not like they're holding a thing. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, sure.
As soon as you see somebody holding it that way, you know you're going to lose.
You know they're legit.
Yeah, like when they got it, you know, like that in their hand, it's done. You're donezo.
DJ Simons as ping pong coach. Yeah. Please, go ahead.
Step one is hold the paddle like that, and then you'll kind of just scare them.
You're vying for your spot in 2024.
I'm giving a little taste of what is to come. I can't reveal, you know, all my tactics, but I can.
Ping pong players out there, you're getting live on-air coaching from your probable future potential coach, the one DJ Simons.
Mm. You want to be my towel boy?
Did they scout the other players? What do they do?
Oh, yeah, you got to be on top of all that.
Oh, I love it. Okay, so DJ Simons as ping pong coach. And thoughts on canoe slalom, Deej?
Canoe slalom. I will say this. If I were to pick a boat to, like, paddle in, it's definitely the canoe. If it's canoe versus kayak.
There are two water slalom-based events in the Olympics. Yeah. One is canoe slalom. One is kayak slalom, Deej.
Yeah. Do you think it is possible to look sexy while standing up in a canoe? I think you're just always a little off balance. It's like taking a picture with an iPad. You can't look good doing it.
And then I do have one huge complaint, Deej.
Just one?
About the Olympics.
Okay.
So I am in. Go Team USA. I'm all in on the Olympics. We know our friend Carrie Heilman, fan. She called in last week. There's a new event. It's women's basketball.
Yep.
But it's 3-on-3 half court.
Okay.
Is this 1920, Deej? Why are the women playing half court 3-on-3? Hey, guys, here's an idea. Add 2 players per team, and then we'll call it basketball.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know enough about basketball to comment on that, but, like, I feel like men and women can both play 5-on-5 full court.
Dude, there's the WNBA. That's my point. Yeah. You know that there's a freaking 5-on-5 basketball from the time they're born until the professional WNBA. Why is women's basketball 3-on-3, Deej? Come on.
It's weird. It shouldn't be. I don't know the reason, but I know it shouldn't be.
I mean, give me airsoft. Yeah. Give me skating. I'm in on those events, but have the women's basketball be 5-on-5.
I just want to see the best of the best. And if it's not the best of the best, it's just not that interesting.
And does that include badminton, Deej?
Yeah, I want to see the baddest of the bad. Remember in the 90s when bad meant good? It still means good when you're talking about badminton.
Friends, we are having a fundraiser. This station, this very station,
WCMLP,
our beloved WCMLP Chapel. We're having a disc golf fundraiser. Let me tell you why we picked disc golf, Deej. Yeah. Anybody can play it.
Yeah, you don't have to be cool. You can wear a hat. You can not wear a hat.
If you can throw a disc, you can play disc golf.
If you cannot throw a disc, you can commission a disc thrower to throw the disc for you, and we'll just be like, that's okay.
Or be a volunteer. So it's the last Saturday in August at our beloved Anderson Park disc golf course.
Hank Anderson. That's my happy place.
It's a great park.
I love that park.
If you don't want to play disc golf, or maybe your spouse wants to play, there's a dog park there, Deej.
Yeah.
There's 2 incredible playgrounds there. Mm. That's where we play softball.
I've taken my dog to that dog park.
We're going to have an ice cream truck there.
Had some great memories on that softball
field. Great memories. Keep that in mind, friends. It's the WCOM Classic. It's a fundraiser for this ramshackle station that we love so much. Mm.
Chris, you and I met at Hank Anderson Park.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Just when I thought I couldn't love Hank Anderson anymore, after hearing that, now I actually love it a little bit less. Sorry, Deej. Reverse psychology.
Fair.
What a guess, friends. Tonight, Deej, Rissi Palmer.
Rissi.
We have really outdone ourselves.
All right.
She lives in Durham.
Cool.
She's a good spot. Here we go. She's played in the Grand Ole Opry twice. Here we go, bud.
Nice.
Yeah, that's Rissi's mom, Donnie. And that's my grandmother. And that's actually Rissi, the baby. She was just born.
She tried on that old clothesline. You'd say, child, wash your feet before you come inside to eat. I'd show up at the start of June. August always came too soon. As we'd pull away in our Ford door, you'd stand crying on your front porch.
song, Deej.
Good stuff.
Let's see if we got her. Rissi Palmer, are you with us?
Hey, I'm here.
Rissi, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. How are you guys doing?
Oh, my goodness. I love that song so much, Rissi.
Aw, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
I know you have a lot of other material. We'll get into all that, but that song hits for me on a bunch of levels.
When we were writing it, that's kind of what we were hoping for. Like, everybody can, on some way, relate to, like, a place that you've been, that you've visited, that kind of reminds you of Somerville or, like, the whole experience.
Oh,
so.
Yeah.
It means a lot to hear you say that.
You used to get dropped off at your grandma's house for the entire summer.
Yeah.
I could connect with that.
Yep.
Like, we would go to my cousin's for, I'm from like a quote-unquote city in West Virginia. But Oak Hill, West Virginia, where my cousin Jimmy and Allison and Jennifer are from, we get dropped off for like weeks at a time. Shoes optional.
Mm-hmm.
Play all day. Mm-hmm. Like, I totally, yep. I love it.
Rissi, where's your Somerville?
Georgia, right?
Georgia?
Yeah.
It's in Jemmer. I was about to say Jemmerville. It's in Georgia, in between Chattanooga and Rome.
Okay,
nice.
Or if you don't know where Rome is, between Chattanooga and Atlanta.
Gotcha. Kind of North Georgia.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Cool.
I also love about that song that the way you kind of woo. Like, I'm not gonna do it because I'll sound awful. But she goes woo, and then like ties in Highland Avenue. Woo. I love how you tie in the woo with the Highland Avenue.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome. And welcome to the show, Rissi Palmer, country artist, two-time performer on the Grand Ole Opry stage, Deej.
Wow.
Actually, it was five.
Five-time performer on the Grand Ole Opry. I'm going to change that and edit.
You blew it, Chris. Five-time performer on the Grand Ole Opry.
We wish you were here in front of us today. But the next best thing, I went on your website and I bought a revival poster signed by you.
Life size.
A couple of months ago. No, it's 12 by 12.
Chris.
So we are looking at
it. We don't have those on the website.
Yeah,
we don't have the budget for life size.
We do have a signed poster of you in the studios.
When I was writing to you, I was in Nashville. And I was just getting home. Like, I knew I was going to be getting home, and my flight ended up being so delayed that I didn't get here until this morning. So
it's all good. We're happy. Didn't you do, right before the pandemic, your entire revival album live performance at the Art Center, right?
I did, yeah. It was, gosh, yeah, that was the last kind of big show before, like, before everything happened this last year. We had a great time.
The good old days, right?
Yeah, right. Before you start looking at people like, why are you coughing? Like, a lot of, definitely the good old days.
But you're in Durham, North Carolina.
Good spot.
I am.
DJ lives in
my town. Oh, my gosh, I love it. Yeah,
big
I love
fan.
It here.
The best is yet to come for Durham, I think.
Oh, my goodness.
I hope we can maintain the good stuff about Durham all this.
What's your favorite thing about Durham? What makes you love to live there?
So I've lived in Los Angeles. I've lived in Atlanta. I've lived in New York.
Yep. Nashville.
And Nashville, all of that. And in all those places, they're music city.
Mm-hmm.
And the Triangle is a music place. Durham's a music city, for sure.
Yeah.
But the difference is the arts community here, I've never felt like the same kind of tension and underlying competition that there is in New York or Nashville or Los Angeles or Atlanta.
Yeah.
This is like truly a community. Artists get together and find out what you do, and they're not sizing you up. They're just like, hey, would you like to collaborate? Maybe we can do this event together. We can do this song together. We can do this organization together.
I totally
and
agree.
And it feels like family. Yeah.
There's something special about cities the size of Durham. I call it a triple-A city. So the Durham Bulls are a triple-A team. We don't have a major league team. But we've got a triple-A team. It's one level below. And I think there's something about that size. It kind of strikes that perfect balance between, you know, it's like a city. You got everything you want in a city. But you can kind of have a community, too.
Yes, 100%. That's the beauty of it. That's why, you know, I think it's awesome. All the great things that are coming to this area and that are happening. But at the same time, I hope and pray that it maintains that community spirit, that catch-all spirit that it has that I love, and not, you know, not lose it.
Yeah. You also do some children's music.
Yes, I do. I still do.
Yeah.
I haven't done another children's album, but I've worked on some other projects in the last year.
So Karen Kay is a friend of mine, and actually,
yeah,
and a neighbor, and she's a huge fan of yours, and she was who introduced me to you in the first place. And it's funny, we go back and forth about like kids' music and adult music, and every time we say adult music, we're like, otherwise known as music, you know?
Right. But,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, that's how I first heard about you, and it wasn't a competitive thing. It was exactly what you just said. It was like, oh, I want to collaborate. Let's.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That spirit of collaboration that you just talked about.
Yeah, it's just a different vibe here. Like, it just really is. I think because of what Durham was and everything that happened here, I think that people, it's just a spirit that you get when you're here.
You put out your album Revival not that long ago. We'll call it adult material.
That my makes adult it sound weird.
Okay. So, Rissi, what would be more exciting to you, to fill an auditorium because you're out doing a kid's album or an adult album? Or do you even think that way?
I don't think that way. I mean, like, kids are great.
They're the best.
And I have to be honest with you, though, you work harder. I'm doing an interview, babe. My child just came in, and I just, as I said, kids are great.
The kid
just came in and jumped on my head.
The kid who should be asleep.
Right, the one that should be in bed right now. Okay. Anyway, yeah, kids are awesome. And I actually feel like sometimes you're working harder when you're trying to entertain kids because they're not quite as forgiving as adults.
I think our daughters are similar ages. I have an 8-year-old, and yours is maybe a little bit older.
Yeah, I have a 10-year-old.
Right on.
Yep. Sorry. You know what? I don't really think of it like that, because if I'm filling up an auditorium either way, I'm pretty geeked about that.
Yeah.
So I think I'd take both.
So you've done the Grand Ole Opry 5 times. Forgive me. I thought it was, well, 2. I feel like 2 got a lot of attention, maybe because it was your first and your most recent. But you've
done, my first and the most recent, yeah.
Compare and contrast, Rissi, because again, I know a little bit about your story, just getting ready for tonight. You had a huge hit. Maybe got disillusioned with Nashville a decade ago, figured out a way to kind of do it on your own, which I'm so impressed with. I want to dig into that more. But then all of a sudden, kind of this last time, compare and contrast your first time on the Grand Ole Opry stage with the one you did most recently.
I mean, the first one is amazing, and it's amazing because it's the first time. But
yeah,
I'll be honest, I kind of think this last one, because the circumstances were completely different. Like, I was getting to play music that I had since written and released on my own, without the help of a record company or any of that.
Right,
and
man,
any of the success after that, you know, was me and the people around me just like rebuilding.
Yeah.
As awesome as the first time was, I think this time meant a little bit more. And plus, my girls were there. And my family there.
The family's
and
there.
And they got to see. Yeah, the first time I went, I was a single girl.
Young lady.
And this time.
You're still a young lady.
And so this time, you know, I had my husband and my two daughters, and that was pretty incredible.
Black male on foot, 591D, acting erratic, possibly armed, code 3.
Brothers and sisters, don't believe what you've been sold. They can bury your body, but never touch your soul. They built you a prison and locked up your mind. Made you think you're nothing and filled your head with lies. Can't act too free, act too proud, shine too bright, speak too loud. When they try to cut you down, that's when you gotta stand your ground. When they bury our dreams, we push them up through concrete. We growing where they can't see. These roots run deep, cause we are seeds. When we rise up, no weapon can stop us. No wall can block us. No hate can't stop. Strength and wisdom teach your children what they were. Cause home with truth and mercy, they won't fall to anyone. They're standing on our shoulders, reaching for the sun. When they bury our dreams, we push them up through concrete. We growing where they can't see. These roots run deep, cause we are seeds. When we rise up, no weapon can stop us. No wall can block us. No hate can't stop love. We are seeds. Hey, I said we are seeds. Yeah. So the battle is now, and we are the army. The battle is now. We are the army. I said the battle is now, and we are the army. I said the battle is now. It's now. It's now. Right now. Hey, when they bury our dreams, we push them up through concrete. We growing where they can't see. These roots run deep, cause we
telling video, Rissi.
Yeah. Yeah, it's my favorite visual that I've ever done.
It is beautiful and timely and just amazing work.
Thank you. I have to give all credit and praise to Emil Gallardo. He is the gentleman that wrote the treatment.
Emil Gallardo.
And directed the video.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Your focus is that, you know, if you're an independent artist just coming up, it's very difficult. It's one thing to have a hit. It's very difficult to make a career out of being a performer, being a musician.
Yeah.
Particularly a black female country musician. It's very difficult. But your whole point is a lot of it you can do on your own. You can kind of recreate the model, so to speak. And that's your, like, I want to talk about your Seeds initiative a little bit.
Sure. So that was a great synopsis of everything. Basically, so I've been independent, Lord, at this point.
Over a decade, over 10 years.
Yeah, like 11 years, I think, 11 or 12 years. When you first leave a record label, like I remember for the longest time, I just thought, like, I'm going to do all this work to get this project ready and I'm going to find a record label.
Right.
Because that's the only way that I knew how to do it. And when we put out the children's record, my husband and I, he would just sit sometimes on his lunch break and just send emails out to all the independent retail stores around the triangle and different places to get the CD put in and like that sort of stuff, because we realized that we were going to have to do this ourselves if we didn't want to spend a small fortune.
Yeah.
And so you figure out pretty quickly, okay, so I remember when launch happened, the publicist did this. So how did she do that? And then you just sit there and you try to figure that out. Okay, so these are the things that I need. These are the things that are important. And it was kind of trial by fire. And so I knew now, with the blessing that comes along with having a platform, which Apple Music gave me a platform.
Yeah.
It was like, I want to try to figure out different ways to help different people. Like, I don't want to just help BIPOC artists, which is what we do on specifically on my show. But then I also want to help all artists. I want to make sure that everybody's taken care of. And so how do you do that? And so that's where the idea for the Seeds Initiative came from. Just basically dispelling these falsities or like the mythical legend that is getting a record deal or being, you know, a signed artist. there's somebody just like you that is pressing these buttons and figuring out how to get these things out, and you can be that person.
That's exactly it.
And, I mean, bigger than all of that, I just want people to feel empowered. Mm. At times when I was being rejected by record labels and, you know, not getting the response or the attention that I felt I wanted, it can feel very personal, and it can feel like rejection, and it is rejection, and it can feel like, you know, maybe you're not good enough, or maybe you need validation. And what I hope everybody gets from this is, like, you can provide your own foundation.
Yeah.
Like, you can do this. You can do it yourself. You can be empowered.
Here's what I found interesting, Rissi. So exactly to your point, you don't need all these middlemen to make it happen for yourself. The more middlemen you take out, the less of a big pie you need to be successful.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you a perfect example.
Exactly.
So a band that DJ and I both really like, Electric Six, and they're kind of one of these bands that's like a cult hero type band. They play all over the world, but they play to crowds of 200 to 300 people. And I remember we had the guitarist on this show, and he was like, oh, yeah, the booking agents take care of the book of the gigs. And my first thought was like, wait a minute. I can understand that, you know, maybe Pearl Jam or someone like that needs a booking agent. But why does a band that's booking 300 seats, why not just work directly with the venue? And I think that kind of is what you're talking about, is like, until you make it to a certain level, there's a lot of steps you can cut out and be successful, and you don't need all these different partners. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Well, yeah. I mean, you may find that, like, once you get to whatever it is it your definition of success, you may realize that you don't need any of it.
Yeah.
Like the best example I can think of is Chance the Rapper.
Chance the Rapper had
like a... this, and this is a recent... I mean, there's so many other examples, but this is just a recent person. Like, he was on the Grammys, receiving Grammy Awards and that sort of thing. He did all of it himself.
He's been on SNL.
He put out mixtapes.
He's been on SNL twice.
Yeah, he's had Doritos commercials, like all kinds of stuff. And he was, up until recently, he was an unsigned artist.
Yeah, perfect example.
And he made it to the Grammys as an unsigned artist.
Yeah. Mm.
Oh, so you're from the Pittsburgh area, right?
Yes, I was born in Swickley, Pennsylvania.
Okay. Swickley.
So I had a little, not an argument, but a discussion, heated discussion. Recently, about whether Pittsburgh was the Midwest or not. What do you think?
Oh, jeez.
It's at least kind
of the Midwest, right? But yeah. What do you think?
That's borderline.
It has the feel of a Midwest town.
I think so.
But it's also got that East Coast edge.
Yeah.
Right.
But yes, it's funny that you say that. I never thought about it until just this minute. But yeah, it does. It kind of feels like a Midwest town.
Okay, so one thing about country music is I think there's a lot of expectations that, like, you have to be genuine, you have to be from a certain place, probably dress a certain way, etc. Do you kind of, how did you end up in country, and how did that kind of play with your background?
My entire family is from the South.
Okay.
We were literally the only family that, like, the only of my dad's brothers and sisters and the only of my mom's brothers and sisters to leave the state of Georgia.
Wow.
And go north.
Yeah.
I spent pretty much every summer and every holiday with my family in the South. And so I felt like I was from Atlanta, even though I really wasn't from Atlanta.
Right.
And my parents brought a lot of that stuff into our house. My mother was the one that played country records in the house, and I just loved the stories. I loved the way the music sounded, like everything. And so I got into the idea of, I'm going to write these songs like this. Cause I was I've always known I wanted to be a singer.
I love it.
And when I got older was when I started thinking about it, like, okay, well, maybe this isn't a viable thing for me, someone like me, to do, because I don't really see a lot of people like me doing this. I met some managers, and they were interested in, like, pop music and wanting to do that. Because, you know, at that time when I was graduating high school, like, Beyonce was starting to become a thing, and on her own without Destiny's Child, and Lauryn Hill and Mariah Carey. mm-hmm. and all these kind of pop divas or whatever. And that's the direction that people wanted to push me. I was a young black girl that could sing. And so, okay, well, then let's make her a pop star. And we started talking one night, and they were just like, well, what are you writing in that notebook all the time? And I said, I'm writing country songs. And they were like, really? Sing some. And so I sang one, and they were just like, oh, my God, Rissi, that's your thing. And so they were really the ones, my first managers, who pushed me to pursue it. They were just like, you love it. You write it. You sing it. Like, you need to just, let's just do it.
I love it.
Yeah.
Well, here's what Rolling Stone said about you. So believe it or not, I still get the hard copies of Rolling Stones, Rissi.
Nerd!
I've got it in my hand right now. I credit my mother-in-law, Patty. She bought a lifetime subscription to the hard copy of Rolling Stone like a decade ago.
Wow.
And I get
that's
every.
Awesome.
Here's what Rolling Stone said about Rissi Palmer, setting country's records straight. Rissi Palmer has long noticed problems with the way people talked about race and country music. I'd see all these things. I'm like, that's not true. That's not complete. Palmer says the North Carolina-based singer who pursued a mainstream career in the mid-2000s interviews guests on Color Me Country. I won't do the whole article, but so Rissi Palmer in Rolling Stone. Congratulations on that, my friend.
Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
What's that like? How do you know you're going to be in it? Do they call you and say, hey, this is Rolling Stone, Rissi, we're going to feature you? How does that part all come together?
I mean, it was kind of like that. It was, they called my publicist.
Okay.
And they were just like, hey, you know, we've been watching everything, all the press and attention around the show. And yep. We really, you know, love what she's doing. And we love the fun that she created. And so we would like to make her a part of the Future 25.
Is she
open to that?
Were you open to that, Rissi?
That's the email. Yeah. And it's like, call me. And we're on the phone. And she's like, oh, my gosh. And so she tells me what's going on. And Shotzi, my publicist, she's a character. She's just like, okay, so what do you think? And I was like, what do you think I think? Yes.
That'd be funny if you'd be like, no, I'm good. I'm good.
Not right now. No. I've known about it since either April or May, because that's when they start putting everything together.
Yeah.
But I couldn't talk about it until it came out.
Do you know anyone else besides me who has a hard copy of Rolling Stone? That's my question.
I do.
Oh, yeah. Me and Rissi.
How many times did you play?
Barnes & Noble. Got it.
Nice.
When did you realize, like, hey, I'm in the big leagues now? Was it, like, the first time you played the Opry? Was it something else? Was it the show that you're on now? What point?
Yeah, was it doing our show? Is that when you knew you were in the big leagues? Or?
It was tonight.
Aside from our show.
That's a good answer, Rissi.
What was the second most pivotal moment?
Second most important night.
Because it can be a bit of a gradual process, but was there a point where
you know what?
Yes.
Like the year 2008. 2008 was really cool because... That was the year that I walked the red carpet for both the ACM and the CMA, and I ended up in the new, like in the USA Today, the morning after the ACMs that year, and I was in like the best dress column, and I was freaking out because I was like, oh my God, that's crazy, like that's me.
That's
and I was
awesome.
Like, and I'm in the best dress, and that makes me very happy. But
DJ and I are usually in the worst dress column, so we cannot relate. You do always look fly, so I'm not surprised.
I usually just wear my softball uniform.
Yeah, people usually tell me I look like I slept in my car last night. That's the
which
normal.
You did.
Oh.
Yeah. Now, Rissi, I'm looking at your album cover here for Revival.
Yeah, we have your album cover right here signed.
Beautiful art. We got Rissi wearing a beautiful dress, kind of some angel imagery going on.
Do you see the vinyl in the background?
Yeah, kind of like a large vinyl record. Very colorful. Lots of pink, green, blue, orange. And in big letters, Revival. What's going on here? What's the Revival?
Yeah.
What does this mean to you?
Thank you. Well, first of all, that was done by Kooky Collages.
Kooky Collages?
Out of Nashville.
Yeah. Nice.
Uh-huh. She's Mary Harrington is the artist's name. And she came up with that. I sent her the music, and I told her what the album meant to me. So, like, what the title means. This was my first full-length project since my debut album.
Right.
you know, in between 2007 and 2019, in those 12 years.
Moving to North Carolina.
I have a family now.
Having a couple kids.
I'm married.
Yeah.
Have two babies. I've experienced loss of a child. I've lost of family members that were here then that aren't here now. Like really pivotal, important family members. And a lot of life. And a lot of being able to kind of look back on the situation and find my responsibility in it, in addition to, you know, placing blame on those that they deserve it, but just having perspective on a lot of things that I didn't have perspective on, things that used to break my heart that don't anymore because I understand a little bit better. And so it just felt like new beginning. Hmm. That's what it all meant. And when I saw the angel wings, I was like, okay, like...
yeah, it sends a strong message, doesn't it?
That was the one thing that I was kind of on the fence on when I saw the imagery, because I didn't want anybody to think that I'm, like, making myself some sort of angel or deity or something like that.
That's great.
With the vinyl right behind it, I think it looks cool, though. Like, the wings by themselves, I see what you're saying, but then when you have the vinyl record backdrop, I think it looks cool.
Oh, no, I mean, it's awesome. I just, you know, I just wanted to be sure that everything on that cover and everything that was a part of that made sense and sent the correct message.
I dig it.
It was just a message of, like, a new beginning. Yeah.
Let's your podcast, Color Me Country, the people you've had on that are blowing my mind, Rissi. Dom Flemons, Queen Esther, just to name a few. Darius Rucker, of course. I'm going to gravitate to him a little bit. Frankie Stat, you named your podcast after Linda Martell. And I know that her granddaughter right now, I think it's right now, is making a movie about her life. Are you involved in that movie at all? Or
you know, I've been talking about her and named the show after her.
Yeah.
And she's reached out to me. Linda and I have actually corresponded with each other, and it was amazing. But as far as involvement in the documentary, I'm not involved.
You have comments.
Wanting to, I did help with raising money.
Yeah,
because they needed
to
do this independently, and it's very important that they did it independently. I'm super excited about it because it's in her work. Like so much of what's written about her is written about her, and like this is an actual opportunity to hear what Linda has to say from her own mouth about what happened. So I'm super excited about
that's awesome. That is so cool. Linda Martell is a true trailblazer in country. Rissi Palmer carrying on that tradition. You're going to be at the Garner Performing Arts Center on Thursday, August 5th in Garner, North Carolina. Duke Performance at the American Tobacco Amphitheater. That's a cool spot on Wednesday, September.
I know. I love that little area.
That's a great area. I'm so glad you're playing there. Other than those two gigs, anything else?
My radio show, Color Me Country.
Color Me Country.
Is on Apple Music, and you can listen without a subscription the night that it airs live. It airs on Sundays, every other Sunday from 7 to 9 p.m. Mm. I have Johnny Swim on the show this week.
I've seen them live, Rissi. They played at Cat's Cradle. It's a husband and wife, right?
Yes, they're fantastic. Because the show is not just Black artists, it's Latinx artists, Indigenous artists, Asian artists, anybody that falls under the BIPOC. It's been really fun, and like you can anything that you want to know about me, about upcoming shows, about the radio show, about the artist fund, just go to RissiPalmerMusic.com.
RissiPalmerMusic.com. Thank you so much for calling in. It's been a pleasure. I really appreciate it.
Same here.
Yeah, and I look forward to meeting you down the road.
Same here. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I really, really appreciate it. And thank you for being understanding, because y'all, this is the second time that I had to... I felt so bad. We were sick the first time. So thank you.
Hey, have a good night. We'll catch you down the road, Rissi.
All right. Thanks, Rissi.
All right. You take care. Good night.
All right. Take care. Bye.
Dancing and he laughed just like you used to. He squeezed my hand and teased me just like you used to. And so close to my lips the words came. in so many ways. You both are the same. The only difference in the two is that I still love you. Yes, I kissed him, but I also called your name. The only difference in the two is that I still love you. Yes, I kissed him, but I almost called your name. Yes, I kissed him, but I almost called your name.